Transmission begins.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
This is the Josh Tolley Show on the GCN Radio Network.
Well, the economy is wonderful. Employment is at a pretty low number. The stock market is hitting record highs. The economy is just booming at the seams. America is poised for a great future. Tax revenues are at all-time highs. Nothing could be wrong, right? Not so quick, says Andy Gauss. He's the author of The Secret World of Money and Uncle Sam Cooks the Books. He's joined us before. Always a great guest. Andy, welcome to the show. How are you doing, sir?
Doing great, Josh. Thanks for having me.
So, the economy. I mean, obviously, it's wonderful. Obama said so, right?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. I love how they count unemployment. Have you discussed that yet?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. That 37% of the people of the workforce, people between the ages of 16 and 64, have just stopped looking for jobs. And because they've stopped looking for jobs, they've stopped counting them as part of the workforce. So I guess the easiest way to make unemployment go to zero is to just have everyone who doesn't have a job now stop looking, and then we'll have zero unemployment.
And everybody will be happy.
Yes, well, the Obama administration will be happy because they sure are trumpeting this, you know, low unemployment. When you stop counting people, if you put those folks back in, Josh, our unemployment rate's approaching 20%, and that's ridiculous. I mean, we can't have 20% of the workforce just sitting home on the couch being non-productive. That's not how you grow a country.
Well, and even if you look at the people who are employed and their underemployment numbers are so high, and then you take into account that Obamacare is forcing a lot of employers to keep part-time employees, and that's actually going to increase the problem. So that problem's actually going to get worse. We know it's going to get worse over the next several years.
Indeed, yeah, evidence is all around. And in the one bright spot where we are, where we have created high-wage jobs, and that's in the oil industry, with our lack of action vis-a-vis ISIS and our failure to rein in the Saudis, we've allowed oil to plunge in price. Well, that might be good for us at the pump. It certainly hasn't done any good in the oil patch. The layoffs have already started. The rig count is down. And I anticipate that that's not going to help the employment numbers in the first and second quarter of this year.
Well, and when you look at the reason for the drop in the oil price anyway, like you were referencing, it's 80% political, 10% geopolitical, and then, you know, 10% market. So it's really crazy what we've done there. But let's talk a little bit about how they change numbers, because this is amazing to me. I constantly try to point it out to listeners. They tout one number on Monday, like, oh, you know, economic growth is here, and it's front page news. And then on Friday, on page 4, they recalculate the numbers, and oh, well, retail sales weren't as great as we thought they were.
Yes, that's right. Revisions. Yes, they do the revisions. They bring out the big number, the number that will calm the markets, and then while no one's looking, they revise the number, either up or down, whatever they need to do. And this has been, you know, past practice, and it's just gotten much worse under the Obama administration.
So what about the value of the dollar itself? I mean, is it strong in the global marketplace, or is it just a facade as well?
Well, we're the cleanest dirty shirt in the laundry, you know, there's no doubt about it. When the euro was having its problems, Josh, folks in Europe would flock into Switzerland. They would convert their euro into Swiss francs and then run back to Europe, knowing that their money was safe in Switzerland. Now, this left the Swiss with abnormally strong currency and a pile of euros that they didn't know what to do with. So the Swiss central bank said, well, that's it. We're not going to support the Swiss franc anymore. We're just going to, you know, create as much of it as we need to keep it in check with the euro. And this, of course, caused the European community to look across the pond. And we still still pay people to keep money in the bank. And I know I've heard folks complain about the low rates of interest, but there are countries in Europe right now where you get negative interest. They charge you to keep your money in the bank. So what's a person to do? Well, simply convert their euro into dollars and buy treasury bills, bonds, and notes. So, yeah, we have been exporting our inflation, and countries around the world, individuals around the world, have stored their wealth in U.S. dollars. In fact, if you look at the MZM metric, when the crisis started in 2007, there were $6 trillion in liquid money sloshing around in the system. Today, there are $13 trillion sloshing around the system. So all of this money has to seek a haven, a home, a place. And the stock market and bond market in the United States have enjoyed the fruits of this upheaval. But I assure you that once the situation in Europe rights itself, that hot money will flow right back into Europe and out of the dollar. And that's when the real weakness will set in.
Well, and isn't it true, too? I mean, because you always get those people who say, well, Josh, you know, it trickles down from the stock market and ends up in Main Street anyway. But that's really not the case when people are using the stock market essentially as a bank, because there is no place to get interest on your money. That's not real investment in companies. That's not real manufacturing that's trickling down. That's just the only place to stick money at the moment.
Absolutely right. And then the companies exacerbate the problem by taking that money and buying their shares back.
Yeah.
You know, IBM, Apple, and others. And this gives another, you know, again, false illusion that there's a rise in price when really it's just a contraction in supply. So, yeah, folks are buying into it, and unfortunately, it seems to be the only game in town. The stock and bond markets are about the only place, the U.S. stock and bond markets, are about the only place where you can get a decent return around the world today.
Yeah, which is why you're seeing so much of that foreign money come in. You know, you brought up an interesting concept that I think a lot of people are hearing for the first time, and that's this idea that we're exporting our inflation. Can you just kind of explain that a little bit more, you know, in detail or elementary level?
Sure. You know, the Federal Reserve has created over $4 trillion in new money in the last 7 years. And if you look at their balance sheet, you can clearly see it there. And folks would tell you that, you know, an increase in the money supply of that magnitude, that's like 400%. With a 400% increase in the money supply, we're going to get inflation, massive inflation, hyperinflation. But it's not the case when four of every $5 that they created circulates outside the country. And, you know, this is why we haven't felt the inflation that many have predicted, is that a lot of these dollars have just left the United States, and they're in Europe, they're in the Far East, they're in the Soviet Union, believe it or not. As the ruble collapsed, as much as Vladimir Putin was bad-mouthed in America, average Russians were seeking out dollars to store their wealth in. So $100 bills circulate more in Russia than they do in New York City. Now, this is something that I don't think the average American understands. We are the reserve currency of the world, and you may have heard it said that the dollar has replaced gold, and that folks store their wealth in dollars throughout the world. And as long as they're storing their wealth in dollars, then those dollars are not here at home competing for goods and services. And that's
which gives the appearance of low inflation. Perfect. Andy, stay where you're at. We'll continue this conversation right after the break. All right, Andy, before we get back into this, can you give everybody your website?
The website is AndyGausse, GAUSE.com.
And you have some really cool stuff up there. You have, like, for $29.95, you can get access to over 170 articles, 40-plus radio and audio clips, 20-plus videos in the library. So just amazing stuff. Great website. Everybody should go join and get that stuff. Andy, what's your take on, I guess, let's just piggyback off the unemployment thing, the real unemployment numbers, the government dependency numbers. I mean, we're seeing over 10% of the population on government assistance right now as we speak.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, the food stamp rolls are ridiculous, right? We have some 46 million Americans on the food stamp program, and another 30 million or so getting some sort of government assistance. And it seems as though this is the trend. And it's to keep the populace happy. So as a result, we have these invisible bread lines. So during the Depression, you know, it was easy to go out into the economy and see people lined up at the soup kitchens and whatnot. And here, you just don't see it in this Depression. So we've done a very good job of hiding our poor. But a great many have fallen through the cracks. Here in the big city, you can't walk a city block without seeing somebody living on the street. So it is a sad situation for America, that's for sure.
Do you know, because I really don't know the answer, so I'm wondering if you do. Do you know if when they count those 40 million people, are those the actual recipients? Or are those the people who are, you know, like children of recipients as well? Because if it's the actual recipients, then that's an amazing number, because there's only 120 million households that have income tax filings, period, in this country.
Yeah, no, that's those are the individuals. It doesn't count who they might support with the money they get. So certainly the program is much larger than the numbers indicate.
So if we took out the ability to buy on credit, and we took out the ability to hide the bread lines, and we used the real unemployment numbers,
we would be in a depression.
And again, take out the credit, we're in a depression, aren't we?
Yeah, a clinical depression, exactly right. Yes, and by hiding it, of course, it builds the one thing that our entire system functions on, and that's confidence. You know, if folks aren't confident, they don't keep their money in the bank. And that's kind of what's going on in Greece right now. So typical Grecian is going down to his bank and withdrawing his money and storing it in a box in his mattress or wherever. So we don't have that here. We have a confident America that keeps a bulk of their money in the bank account or in their checking or savings account and has the ability to use their little electronic card or to write their check. And the confidence levels are very high. And I think that's not by accident. I think government wants us to be confident.
I was going to say it's more like stupidity and a false sense of confidence.
Well, I think so as well. I think the biggest problem with investing typical Americans' investments right now is that they've mispriced risk. You know, folks in bond funds and stock funds have really not factored the risk that we could have another 2007-style collapse. You know, Chancellor of the Exchequer of the Bank of England warned that there are going to be severe capital constraints in 2015. Liquidity will dry up as you have three times as much debt, once again, as there is money to pay. Either the Europeans are going to have to increase the supply of money, or the Fed is going to have to reinstitute its capital infusion program, one or the other. The central banks around the world have been flooding the market with money, but the Fed is allegedly backed off of its monetary creation. So we're starting to see the tightness already, and I think by the second quarter it will become clear to all that there just isn't enough money to pay all the bills.
Well, and you know, that's so true, and then we continue to rack up these deficits and these debts domestically, but I want to focus still on the personal level. We have a situation where half of the country, one in two people, don't even have $500 in a savings account. So how do we navigate this?
Well, I mean, I say government should get out of the way, and we should certainly stop altering the landscape as we do. You know, we're willing to trade 10,000 automotive jobs to Korea in exchange for 100 banking jobs. So we say to, you know, South Korea, we'll let you import your Kia automobiles into the United States if you'll let us underwrite bonds in your bond market. So, I mean, to me, this is just bad policy. This free trade, fair trade thing is, I think, where the problems start. When this nation began, we took the majority of our income from the Coast Guard cutters and tariffs, and then the rest of it from owning a portion of the central bank. You know, the first bank of the United States was partially owned by the Congress. And so any profits that it generated stayed in the Treasury. And between the Coast Guard cutters Treasurers and the central bank, we had it made. There was no income tax. We didn't take a third of a person's earnings. So this idea of taxing production and leaving consumption alone has encouraged the importation of cheap goods. And this is another area that I think we're going to see tremendous trouble this year. Already the trade deficit has increased to crazy levels. And I think when the numbers are reported next month, you're going to see an even bigger rise. So fair trade, free trade, and the lack of our ownership of our own central bank is what has put us in this circumstance.
I have my own opinion and view on TPP, but what's your take on that, the Trans-Pacific Partnership?
Yeah, again, you know, anything that reduces our tariffs, I think it's insane that a nation can come to the United States, sell its products here, take that money back to its home country where it's taxed for the benefit of those people, and then use to improve their infrastructure, whatever they do with the money. So it's like we're supporting the entire world through these free trade arrangements. I would have no trouble allowing the United States to stand on its own 2 feet. And I know many would call me an isolationist, but the idea that we're going to tax our citizens and give citizens of other countries a free pass to access our markets just doesn't make any sense to me.
Well, and that's the thing. It doesn't make any sense to anybody. I mean, you would think with tariffs on products, you would get manufacturing back in America. You would get employment numbers up. You would, in a sense, you know, even incentivize tax reform. If we moved away from this income-based tax reform, which is unconstitutional anyway, but if we went to like a fair tax or a free tax or some other sort of just value, I don't want to call it that. So just some sort of flat rate system, you would then make the environment conducive for economic growth. It doesn't seem that hard to fix this. Why don't we see those sort of proposals?
Well, I think the very same people that fund our Congress through their campaign contributions are the same folks that benefit from the idea of free trade. You know, it all started when we started demanding things like, you know, a 40-hour work week and a decent level of safety on our job, and then started asking factories not to pollute the atmosphere. So the owners of these entities decided, well, with a little cooperation from Congress and the elimination of tariffs, they could pick up their entire operations and move them to a place that where they could avoid all of this regulation, which increasingly adds to the bottom line. So we've all heard the stories of the conditions in the factories that make the little Apple iPhones, and then we gladly plunk down, you know, big bucks for one of these things, when in fact it does nothing but contribute to the undermining of all of the regulation we've put in place, not only environmental, but worker safety and decent wage and so forth. So the folks that benefited from all of this are the same ones that fund our politicians' campaigns. You don't see people rallying in the streets with their, you know, free trade or fair trade signs. It is indeed put to the politicians by the folks that fund their campaigns. So we as individuals need to really understand what's going on here and recognize that unless and until we put some protective tariffs at our borders.
Absolutely right. Andy, hold on 1 second. I'm up against a break. Don't go anywhere. Back right after this. All right, Andy, you know, as we look forward to 2016, obviously the economy is going to be once again the number one issue. We're going to have both sides of the political aisle saying that they're the ones to fix the economy. Both sides have evidently failed massively, and there's no signs of hope because none of them are proposing ideas like we're talking about here. What sort of role do you think the economy is going to have on that political season, and is it going to be effective?
Yes, I'm sorry. It's like 1977 all over again, Josh. You know, we would ask Jimmy Carter what impact the economy would have on the election. You know, in this case, obviously, if interest rates remain low and the economy still gives all the appearances of a robust cycle, and that lasts into the election season in 2016, then people might be reluctant to change horses, so to speak. But if interest rates start to rise through the summer of 2015 and into the election season in 2016, and the economy gets much worse, which I anticipate that's what's going to happen, we might just turn out the entire Congress and put in all new guys. So it's kind of up to the Federal Reserve in terms of monetary policy. You know, they like to tout their independence, but if they decide that they would like to see an upset in the Congress, then they certainly would raise interest rates through the summer of 2015 into the election season of 2016 and cause the pain that would send America out to the polls to pull the lever for the other guy, you know. And that's what they've done in the past. I anticipate they may do that this time.
That's crazy how much control they have, even over things that people don't realize, like you just said. I mean, that's basically the Fed is pulling the reins on the American thought process of which candidate to vote for. And that's just heinously evil. What do you think, though? I mean, we talked about this idea that we're in this almost shadow depression. Nobody knows we're really in it because we've hidden it so well through credit and the invisible food lines and so on and so forth. When do you think it hits the fan? Because this cannot go on in perpetuity. At some point, somebody's going to have to suffer for this.
So the decision that was made in 2007, which was, you know, you have three times as much debt as you have money to pay it. And so we either settle everyone's debt at 30 cents on the dollar and start the game again. That would be a deflationary depression. Or we increase the supply of money sufficient so that everyone can pay their bills, or some combination in the middle. I believe they took some combination in the middle. They kicked the can down the road on some of the debt. They rolled a lot of it over for 7 years, which is what's coming due this year. And they increased the supply of money while at the same time reining in interest rates to the lowest possible point. So we've managed to kind of keep a finger in the dike of the crash. Now, a deflationary depression, not a very pleasant sight. Anyone who's lived through one, of course, there might be some old folks around out there that were around for the last depression. It is not a fun scene. And although it would right the economy at the end of it, the wringing out of the excess is very painful. And I don't think that the American people are ready for it. So the Fed has decided to take this stealth inflation approach and to attempt to increase the money supply in such a way that we don't feel it. And then that's essentially what we've done. And I anticipate that's what we'll continue to do. I don't see a deflationary blow-off or a hyperinflationary crash, but a rather a slow, steady inflation that'll turn a current dollar into 50 cents by 2020. And if they can pull that off, well, they'll deprive that 77 million baby boomers who've stashed away $5 or $6 trillion in the last 40 years. They'll have the majority or at least half of their wealth decimated through inflation. Unreal. So that's what I see.
Unreal. So if that's the case, and obviously it's more likely to happen than not.
It's either one or the other. Either people can't pay their bills, or you create more money so they can pay their bills, but you can't have anything in the middle.
Wouldn't it make more sense then to let it crash now? I mean, obviously it's going to hurt either way, but if you keep artificially lifting and lifting and lifting, the fall's going to be harder. Let's just crash it now and rebuild.
Right. And you know, like a forest fire, that would have been the action to take in 2007. You know, clear the ground, sort of make room for new growth. It had all jumbled together. But the administration and the Federal Reserve decided against that. They decided that it wouldn't be in the best interest of America to allow this crash. And let's not forget, that's what the Federal Reserve was allegedly put in place for, to prevent these boom and bust cycles and to give us, you know, they repealed the business cycle and sort of gave us a slow, steady, whatever, they'll call it growth. I call it dilution. But in this way, they're able to solve the problem without revealing it. Imagine if they came hat in hand and said, okay, look, this is what's happened. You know, we allowed for the creation of three times as much money as there is debt, and there's not enough money to pay. And so everybody would just panic like crazy, start pulling their money out of the bank. And let me tell you, you don't want to see that, because we have, if you look at the Fed's balance sheet, there's $1 trillion in printed cash. There's $2.7 trillion in reserve at the Fed. And Americans think they have $12 trillion in their checking account and savings accounts. So there is clearly not enough money to go around. If everyone suddenly decided that the circumstance is going to be bad and so we should go and get our money out of the bank, it would collapse the system overnight. So I don't see that as a possibility. And yes, it would be better, but it's certainly not an avenue that they're going to take.
I don't think most people, well, I hope this listening audience did, because it's the smartest audience in the world, but I think most people in the country wouldn't grasp what you just said, how there's $12 trillion that we think we have. It really isn't there. We could maybe get $2 trillion out, but that's about it, and the rest would just crash the system. Let's say you're a 50-year-old farmer, I don't know, in Walla Walla, Washington. You have $80,000 saved up. You know what you said is true. It's all going to be gobbled up and cut in half in the next 7 to 10 years. What do you do with the 50?
Well, you know, that farmer in Walla Walla already knows. He already has his wealth stored in tangible, real, physical things, right? So he's probably, he already has silver dollars or $20 gold pieces or the old quarters, dimes, and halves from before 1964. You know, these folks generally understand commodity money. Fiduciary money, when someone else owes you money, that's relatively new. This is something for the new generation. President Nixon only closed the gold window in 1971. And if you want to prove this to yourself, all you need is a computer and a few little keys. In the old days, I used to have to write away for this information, but now you can Google St. Louis Fed MZM. And that'll tell you the money with a zero maturity, that's how much money people think they have in their checking and savings accounts. You'll see that number at almost $13 trillion. Then you Google Federal Reserve H41 release, and you can look at total factors affecting reserves. You'll see the reserve balances. It's not even a fourth of what people think they have in the bank. And so what has to happen? Either people remain confident enough to leave their money in the bank, or the system implodes upon itself as the Federal Reserve rushes to monetize the debt. And what I mean by that is, okay, we owe you money. We're not going to say we can't pay, so we're just going to create a new dollar and give it to you. And that's what they've done up till now, and I anticipate we'll continue to do.
All right, give us your website one more time.
Yeah, it's andygoss.com. And I'll tell you, Josh, I have three audio CDs. Federal Reserve is probably my most popular one. It's nothing commercial about it. It just explains how the Fed works. And the second one is the definition of money. What the heck is a dollar anyway? You need to understand that. Mm-hmm. And it, too, non-commercial. The third, that's the one that gives you the full pitch, protecting your wealth with gold and silver coins. That one is commercial. If you'd like to get these, any combination of the three or all three, give us a call and mention you heard it on Josh's show. We'll send them to you free. They're half-hour audio CDs, three of them, and the number is 800-468-2646. You listen to them and make your own determination, because I think once you understand how the system operates, then the solution becomes crystal clear. The Constitution defines what money is. It's in Article 1, and when I hear folks talk about a balanced budget amendment or anything else, we have a constitutional mandate that's being ignored. It is this.
You're right, my friend. We have to have you back on. I look forward to it. We're out of time. Back right after this, folks.